Okay, thank you for that, TurretinFan. TurretinFan, you will now cross-examine Mr. Albrecht for 20 minutes. You may begin when you're ready.
Okay. Well, thank you for your kind words in your opening speech. I really appreciate that you consider me a friend. I hope that we won't part friendship over the sharpness of these questions here. But I'd like to get right into it. What is the what's the evidence that you presented? You presented, if I recall correctly, 20,000 according to one article, and you thought the number is actually higher. Is that correct?
That would be correct. I think I think the number more than likely is way more inflated than 28,000. I believe I said 28,000, I think.
Yes. And so is that if I heard you correctly, that's the kind of disunity and division that you're talking about, is the number of denominations?
Not necessarily. I don't think the number of denominations would necessarily play a big part in the fact that I believe that Sola Scriptura has caused so much disunity. In my opinion, you could have at least just 10 denominations that exist, and the fact that each and every single one of them hold diametrically opposing views when it comes to issues even such as salvation, I think that would be enough to prove that Sola Scriptura causes disunity and division within the Christian body.
Okay, and the kind of disunion, in other words, it's not the fact that, like, that you would imagine that Presbyterians hate Baptists or something like that. It's the fact
not
that
at all.
Denomination
not at all. Oh, absolutely. My argument is not that one denomination hates the other or as such, as I even pointed out in my opening statement. I don't even think pointing out that Miguel Cervantes was burned as a heretic would be proof enough that Sola Scriptura is false. I think that simply the fact that he took an opposing view, and the fact that he held the Sola Scriptura, as well as the people that opposed him, held to the same view, I think that is enough to show that and as well as much more evidence that I put forth is enough to show that Sola Scriptura causes disunity, I believe.
Well, that's a good starting point for my next question, which is you mentioned Miguel Cervantes, but he's not a Trinitarian. Do you still consider him a Christian, even though he's not Trinitarian?
Do I consider him a Christian I don't understand. Do you mean, do I consider him a Christian at the moment, one of the saints in heaven? Is that what you mean?
Do you consider non-Trinitarians Christians?
No, I do not consider them Christians. It would be akin to asking me if I consider a Jehovah's Witness to be a Christian.
Very well. But I guess my point is then Miguel Cervantes is not an example of a division in the body, since he's not in the body.
I think Miguel Cervantes would be a fantastic example because who is in the body then? Well, I know I can't ask questions, but in my opinion, it would bring up the question of who is in the body according to the doctrine of Sola Scriptura. It's pretty much a free-for-all. You can interpret the scripture whichever way you want within Sola Scriptura, so that is what brings about the disunity. I see the same problem within Jehovah's Witnesses. I see the same problem there because a majority of the ones that I know hold to Sola Scriptura. I'm not saying that I would consider them on the same level as a Christian as I would, let's say, consider you or Lane, for example. But nevertheless, they hold to the same teaching. And there's another example of disunity. It leads them directly to deny the divinity of Christ and many other Orthodox doctrines.
You're certainly not saying that the scriptures lead them to deny orthodoxy.
Their interpretation of the scriptures do. I think their adoption of Sola Scriptura is a good example of the disunity that it brings about. I'm not saying that I believe that they're interpreting it correctly. I completely disagree, which is
okay. But when you are affirming the idea that this disunity and division is in the body of Christ, are you referring to people who are united to Christ when you talk about the body?
Are you referring to the fact of people that I believe are, part of the saints? Is that what you're asking?
The resolution which, Mr. Ray has kindly provided to us,
correct,
suggests that it fosters disunity and division in the body, and I'm trying to get at the meaning of the body to you.
Well, quite simple. Well, not so simple, but the way that I would view it would be quite simple. If we we examine the usage of the term body in this sense within Catholicism, at least, and within certain branches of Eastern Orthodoxy as well. I can consider a Protestant, a fellow brethren, a separated brethren, but nevertheless, they have the option, they have the ability to be saved. So yes, I do believe that there are Protestants out there that are in the body of Christ that do have the ability to be saved and do have the ability to get to heaven. So in that case, I think it would be appropriate to say that Sola Scriptura causes and fosters and brings about disunity within the body.
But how about the Jehovah's Witnesses who deny Christ? Are they separated brethren also?
Jehovah's Witnesses, I do not believe that they are Christians. I think whenever you bring up the term separated brethren, it's obviously a phrase that comes out of Vatican II. We're referring to individuals that, although they are separated, they hold views that are similar to us, such as the Trinity, the divinity of Christ. Those individuals would be considered Christians. I do not consider the Jehovah's Witnesses to be Christians.
Okay. And Miguel Cervantes,
I don't think they would be in the body.
Would Miguel Cervantes be one of the separated brethren? I mean, obviously he's not around now after Vatican II.
Right. So let's say if we were to take the position back then, if that term was around, are you asking if he would be considered a separated brethren?
Right.
I do not think so. I think Miguel Cervantes, as I said before, is a prime example of taking the scriptures and interpreting them to his own peril, pretty much.
Okay.
I think Miguel Cervantes.
Very good. I don't want to belabor that point too long.
Okay,
there
no
was a next guy that you brought up who asserted that the scriptures are obscure in many places or almost entirely obscure and denied the perspicuity of scripture. I can't recall the fellow's name. Do you remember his name?
Could you rephrase that question one more time?
In your speech, after discussing
Cervantes,
you mentioned another man.
Oh, okay. Castillo. Yes, absolutely.
And, now, when you think about Sola Scriptura, do you include perspicuity as one of the doctrines of Sola Scriptura?
The perspicuity of the scriptures?
Yes.
It would depend. In my opinion, at least, and I know there are a number of individuals that would disagree with me, I think even within holding the teachings of Sola Scriptura, we have splinterings in how you view Sola Scriptura. I have got a couple of friends that don't hold to that as such. I think your question is fantastic. Castillo held to this doctrine, and he indeed thought that the scriptures were truly obscure. The majority of the people that I know and speak to, I think that they do believe that the scriptures are clear.
All right. And now, when James, the apostle, the Lord's brother, James, says, "From whence come wars and fightings among you? Come they not hence, even of your own lusts, that war in your members," in James 4:1. Is that providing us with an inspired answer to the question of why we have divisions?
I think that provides us a fantastic example of sin, of God not answering what we ask for because our motives are wrong. I don't think that the verse at all pertains to this topic because we read that the reason people have not gotten what they asked for is because their motives are wrong. And I don't think that you're is answered by this question. I think it brings up many more problems. If we're going to adopt James 4:1 and say, oh, we've got so many other denominations because, oh, you know what? They're all of them are wrong. They're all, I don't know if you'd say they're all in sin. They're not asking for God's guidance correctly. And we're asking, I think it brings up even more problems. So who's right then? Who's got the right view of Sola Scriptura? It brings up even more confusion and even more disunity, I believe.
Let me ask you another question. Romans 16:7, in that verse, Paul tells the Romans, "Now, I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses, contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them." In that verse, is Paul the Apostle identifying for us that people are the cause of divisions?
Could you give me that verse one more time?
Romans 16:17, "Now, I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them." Now, does that verse provide us with an inspired answer to the question, what causes divisions, with the answer being that men cause the divisions?
I don't think there's any doubt that men cause the divisions. That is not what I'm arguing. I think that no matter what we hearken to in the scriptures, even this verse, I think that we're going to get right back to the beginning that, okay, well, whose sola scriptura is correct then? There's no doubt that men cause divisions. That is what I'm arguing for. I believe sola scriptura is a man-made doctrine. Even though we're not debating that, I think it's a man-made doctrine. And that is the reason why we have so many divisions and obstacles in the way.
We weren't going to debate whether or not sola scriptura is a man-made doctrine. But
that's correct.
But the people who hold to any doctrine that says that there is some standard of the truth, and they're trying to obey Romans 16:17. How are they able to avoid the people who cause divisions and offenses while maintaining denominational unity with those people?